This week, we finish up an article we started a few weeks ago about the Great Pyramid and initiation. In the wrap-up, it asks the question we all want to know. Does Masonry hold the answers to life's problems? Then, we hear a pitch for a brand new fraternity in 1928, the Fraternity of Osiris, Temple of Memphis. What could this new fraternity offer America in the heartland in Kansas City? Money? Wealth? Health? We'll wrap it up with the long-standing controversy of Shakespeare. Was he a Freemason? All this and more. Stay tuned for this special episode, number 500.
Welcome back to Whence Came You, a Masonic podcast featuring research papers and discussions related to Freemasonry. Here's your host, Brother Robert Johnson.
Welcome back to the show. This is episode number 500. 500 episodes of the Whence Came You podcast. And of course, this is not possible without the wonderful support of our contributors, our fellows, our producers, and of course, our legacy partners. As we've told everybody before, this program has been produced since July of 2011, weekly. Masonic education for anybody interested in Freemasonry and its kindred sciences. This is no small endeavor, requiring hours of work each week on top of what we all have, work, kids, spouses, and fraternity obligations, and other things, right? So I just have to say that it is tremendous to be able to be here after 500 episodes with all of your support and everybody out there who continues to listen to the program. I really appreciate each and every one of you. It is a tremendous honor to be here after 500 episodes. Without a doubt, the overwhelming theme always is one of gratitude. So thank you so much. If you would like to know more about how to become somebody who assists in bringing this program to the masses, over 3 million downloads, head on over to wcypodcast.com, click on Support the Show, and see how you can help support. Aside from monthly donations or one-time donations or just sharing the show, there are other ways. We have things that are in the shop. Of course, we have the producer's pin. We have Max Heindel's Ancient and Modern Initiation Special Edition. We have The Master's Word, a short treatise on the Word, the Light, and the Self, which is a wonderful, great book. Also, we have How to Charter a Lodge, a no-nonsense, unsanctioned guide. And also, It's Business Time, Adapting a Corporate Path for Freemasonry. We've also got some leftover stuff from MasonicCon Chicago, lapel pins, tokens, and of course, our awesome program that we had made. And we've got a couple things coming, right? We have the Craftsman Plus journal and pen, and some other things that are in the works. On the presentation schedule, I just finished doing a new presentation that I have never done before, and I did it for the Lodge of Instruction in Massachusetts. I did a presentation called Complementary Arts of Freemasonry and Tarot. It got some really good feedback and good reviews, so if you're interested in that, let me know. We've also got some other presentations coming up here over the last week. I just did the Tetragrammaton. I did Long Been in Darkness, a look at traditional candidate preparation. And of course, coming up in July, we've got the Masonic Pub Crawl, Freemasonry in America and its Colonial Tavern Beginnings, which is sponsored by Olive Branch Lodge No. 114 in Virginia. So that will be really fun. We've also got August 1st, we're doing a webinar, The Business of Freemasonry, which we'll cover some administrative and business type stuff within the craft. So if you're interested in any of that, you can, of course, check out the website, wcypodcast.com, click on Presentation Schedule, and you'll see all of that. Now, as I mentioned, 2 weeks ago, we were going to finish this article on the Giza Pyramid and initiation. Well, we didn't get to because last week I was actually in Virginia hanging out with Joe Martinez and the fellas who put on the Esotericon 2021 conference, which was awesome. Highly recommend that you start thinking about clearing that weekend for next year, July 10, 11, 12, 2022, because that is the next date which you're going to make sure you're there because it's going to be in person. Everything's back open essentially, and really the only reason they didn't do it this year, it was just too close to the actual date of the event for them to change everything and make it in person. So next year it is in person, and I believe they're also going to do a virtual presentation also. So just make sure you have that date available. Presentations on the 11th, group activity on the 12th, and on the 10th, that first day, there'll be some introductory things going on as well. Probably like a brew night where we go out to a local brewery, have some beers or some Cokes, whatever. Have some great fellowship. It's going to be great. So again, check that out. If you need to be refreshed on what this last article, where we left off, then you're going to want to check out episode number 498. Without further ado, let's finish up this article, The Great Pyramid, A Temple of Initiation, coming from The Initiates and The People magazine. This chamber of burial was most potent as a sanctum sanctorum for the neophyte under training. Here, if anywhere, he could gain entrance to the celestial spheres and make effective the hierarchic invocation. Furthermore, the records indicate that when the neophyte was placed in the sacred coffin in the antechamber, he shortly fell into a deep, trance-like sleep, and while in this condition, he invariably received instructions from the departed initiate souls and hierarchic powers. In the present day, the wise neophyte, who undertakes definite training in soul development, will have a private room which he will use as his sanctum sanctorum. There, by the use of sacred mantrams and other exercises, accompanied by beautiful symbolic rites, the aspirant ultimately may gain access to the hierarchies and their influences. In a degree, this corresponds to the ancient priesthood initiation. It is a slower, less intensive process, but the results are certain if the neophyte is sincere and faithful, sans doubts and disloyalty. It must not for a moment be believed that the Egyptian priests worshipped the hierarchies. Nothing can be farther from the truth. They give worship only to the one God. They recognized many lesser powers. The devotion, the adoration, the aspiration, and the gratitude of these priest initiates were directed to Him as the one in whom we live and move and have our being. But in case of special need and interests, such as the healing of the sick, or a desire for guidance, direction, and wisdom in emergencies, they appealed to and invoked hierarchic assistance, just as we request the help of a friend who is in a position to render help, or seek the services of a physician when we are ill, even though we also pray to God at the same time. Who, for instance, considers that asking for help of a friend when in need destroys worship of the one true God, elevates the friend into a quote-unquote God, or makes a polytheist of the one who thus seeks aid? Let us then judge these ancients as we judge ourselves, for as we judge, so shall we in turn be judged. The chamber of the queen is situated below that of the king. This corresponds to the fact that the child is with its mother before it is with the father. In the queen's chamber, no instructions were given relative to the training and development of the soul powers. Because man alone was permitted to pass through the initiation, in this chamber, however, neophytes were instructed relative to the divine birth and in the laws of beauty, love, and purity as a regenerative power. Here, all the creative laws were exemplified, as well as all that concerns man before he actually enters the path of initiation. The Queen's Chamber, also known as the Chamber of Isis, had a part deep significance in the ancient initiations. From Isis, all things spring. Therefore, Isis, as the goddess of creation, love, and wisdom, holds her own high place in the East and is known as the goddess of the night, while Osiris was known as the god of the sun of the day. Frequently, Isis was called the queen of the East. She is the quote-unquote woman clothed with the sun. Isis, the mother of men. Isis, the womb of the gods. In certain respects, she is equal with man. For man, though possessing the creative power, is impotent without the respective vehicle, the power to receive and bring forth. For this reason, the religion of the Egyptians was superior to all others, in that it recognized one equal with the other, and frequently put Isis in place of Osiris, and in turn Osiris in place of Isis. The lotus, sacred flower of Egypt, was the emblem of Isis, typical of all that is pure and everything that is spiritual. The lotus was to the Egyptians what the rose is to the Rosicrucians. Like the rose, the lotus is emblematic, not of that which it creates, but of that which is created, the resultant of a potency or an effort. In its beginning, the soul does not create. It must be awakened or unfolded and brought to activity, strength, and final illumination, just as the bud of the rose or the lotus is unfolded in the rays of the sun. The legend of Osiris, Isis, and Horus is known to all students of mysticism. Osiris, listening to the tempter Typhon, is murdered. Isis departs in search for him. She finds him, but discovers that the most important part of him is missing. Nevertheless, she conceives and brings forth a son, Horus, who succeeds to the throne of his father Osiris. In this, we read the story of the soul, every soul. The soul in the heavens listens to the voice of desire, the tempter, leaves its state of bliss, and takes on a body. The one important part, the godly state, is lost, submerged through the act of physical birth. Isis, however, which is the soul hidden in the body, permits no rest, but constantly urges on and on until at last man, or the mind of man, listens to the voice of Isis, the soul. And thus Isis conceives, takes on life, and the son is born, the soul awakens. And when the soul grows in strength, to manhood, to power, and to illumination, it takes the place of the father. It occupies the throne or the seat of government, direction. In the Great Pyramid there is, besides the king's and the queen's chambers, and the antechamber, the subterranean chamber. This represents man, as he usually is, living the carnal life according to the dictates or the desires of the selfish man. Man, or the soul of man, came from a pure state. He was Osiris. He descended and took on flesh, and thus inhabits the subterranean cave or passage. Here he may remain, possibly never freeing himself from his undesirable environment. However, gradually, if he but listens to the voice of Osiris within, he will travel upwards until he reaches the queen's chamber. There he will be instructed in, and must accept as the rule of his life, the law of love, beauty, and righteousness, or rightness. As he masters these lessons, he will be permitted to leave this chamber, working upward by degrees until he finally reaches the antechamber. Here he must remain until he has, in a measure, freed the flesh from much of its carnality, and has been given divine instructions and guidance, after which he will be permitted to enter the king's chamber. There he receives his final initiation, thus attaining illumination of the soul, conscious immortality, or sonship with God. Only by this path, or way, can man reach the exalted third degree. From all this, we can readily see that the Egyptians had a worthy purpose in building the Great Pyramid, their hall of initiation, the sublime temple which today stands so that all may see it, not a legend, but a reality, symbol of the perfect man. It has been accused that the Great Pyramid was dedicated to the sun god. Osiris was not the sun god of the Egyptians, but the symbol of the one god. Ra was their sun god. To the Egyptians, the sun was not something to be worshipped, but an emblem of the soul of man, which, when perfect, would take its rise in the east, follow its natural course by way of the south, proceed to the west, and thence return to reappear again in the east, and thus eternally follow its course to greater perfection. As the Great Pyramid was to Egypt, so was the Temple of Solomon to the Hebrews. Though Solomon's temple is but a legend now, its meaning, its message, is the same, and its purpose identical. The symbolization of the Temple of Solomon, which is accepted and honored by the Christian, while biased and unfairly he regards with suspicion the temples of Egypt, is of the same nature. Solomon is neither more nor less than a word for the sun. Sol is the Latin, Am the Chaldean, and On the Egyptian. Each syllable having the same meaning, the sun. Whether Solomon's temple or Cheops, these edifices are symbols of the greater sun. The soul of man, which provided the temple, is perfected. It will rise in the east, take its course by way of the south, thence to the west, to rise again and yet in the east eternally. What a lesson for every master mason and every sincere neophyte on the path leading to initiation. It is of marked significance that the apex of the Great Pyramid was never finished. This is to be accounted for by the fact that though the Egyptian priests had reached initiation, there was one inheritance to which they had not attained, namely, the immortalization of the entire being, true godhood. The pyramid as it stands is a symbol of what man has been able to accomplish when he had been able, up to that point, to do with himself. The Egyptian priests knew that the ultimate of man would be entire or complete immortality. This he had not accomplished, though he had been looking forward to it. So the pyramid of design was left unfinished as to its ultimate point, the apex meaning ultimate completeness at the center. Until such time as man should be able to finish within himself the great work of which the pyramid has stood throughout the centuries as a symbol. Nor is the time ripe for this grand completion, for man has by no means reached the ultimate, and, due to his ignorance, is far from having attained the goal of physical immortality and the quote-unquote heaven on earth foreshadowed in the Revelation. The reason for this incompleteness is that his philosophy is still imperfect. The philosophy to which man still subscribes teaches that death is necessary in order to reach the essentials of knowledge. Man does not take into consideration that the number of times death is met, whether once or 100 times, is to be determined by the progress he has made, and that it is possible, if he is willing to make the necessary and conscious effort, for him to attain far, with and in his soul, in one lifetime, as much as might be accomplished without due effort in 100 incarnations. The Egyptians did not understand that having met death once, a second time would not be necessary, but that in the second life, the ultimate might be reached if he could succeed in banishing the race belief in the necessity of death. It is this race consciousness which all of us have inherited, and from which all men must free themselves in order to attain the goal. The incomplete state in which the pyramid was left should not be a disappointment to the student of symbology any more than the use of a substitute word should be to the master mason. Let it be rather a cause of more persistent effort to realize in his own experience the ultimate apex of unity, and to find the ultimate center within himself. In days to come, the march of progress will usher in the fullness of time, which will make it possible for the coming race or race of humanity to crown the Great Pyramid of Egypt with the apex of completeness. It is the duty of us who know to do our best toward hastening that day when humankind will have earned, by right of effort, not through attempting to lean upon mere man or mediator, the right to add its contribution to the world's greatest symbol in stone. To the true Master Mason, the one who has studied his symbolic philosophy well, the pyramid is an exposition in stone of his initiation in Masonry. To him also, Masonry is a guide, step by step, the mystery of the pyramid. Most significant of all, he will remember that, quote-unquote, the word long has been lost, that he is now using a substitute, and that his initiation, though sublime, is incomplete, as is the Great Pyramid, so long as he himself, within himself, does not succeed in finding the true or original word. When man has perfected his philosophy and has succeeded in living the life that leads to the immortalization of his entire being, then will the Great Pyramid be crowned by him, and when Masonry finds its lost word, then Masonry also will be completed. Let this be a prophecy to the craft. When, and not before, Masonry has found its lost word, when it has sought and found the spirit of its symbolism and philosophy, will the Great Pyramid be completed. When this has been accomplished, man shall have attained to complete immortalization, and the millennium of the Revelation will have dawned. May we look to the Masonic craft for help in the great work, or will it continue to be purely materialistic? Let this be the mission of Masonry, to perfect the work for which its outer symbolism stands. Shall it be so? So there we have the completing of this particular article here in this magazine. Reading this magazine, it is very much clear that whoever the author was and the influence behind the magazine definitely has Masonic undertones. It is definitely talking about Freemasonry in name in the article. Again, as I mentioned in episode 498, this strikes at the core of something I remember from Manly P. Hall's Lost Keys of Freemasonry, a wonderful book for a Master Mason to read, I think is particularly of note to say. I really, if you're an EA or a fellow craft, please don't read that book yet. It just is not going to have the same effect on you. But I think this text, you know, kind of echoes some of those sentiments. And we said in the past that this article came out a few years after the publication of Lost Keys of Freemasonry. So not crazy that we would see some of that influence here, but also this last bit in the article where it's saying, may we look to the Masonic craft for help in the great work? So if they're asking a question like, does Masonry have the things that it takes to assist the world today? Is it still relevant? And then the secondary question, or will it continue to be purely materialistic? This particular issue was written back in 1928, so they're saying then in 1928, Masonry was pretty materialistic. I have to say it still is today for the most part. I mean, we've got a lot of rank and file type administrative bodies, right? And we're all about those lapel pins, and they are cool. Like, I love putting a cool symbol on a lapel pin, but just collecting lapel pins for the sake of collecting them is kind of, it is materialistic. So they asked this question, you know, is Masonry still relevant? Can we look to Masonry to solve the problems of today? Does Masonry teach those things? I know what I think, right? And I think if I ask that question in Craftsman Plus, I think it really depends on how we best can exemplify the values that Freemasonry teaches us and to live those things so that people try to emulate the same way, those honorable practices that we all have. So for our Craftsman Plus, I'd like to ask you, what problem of today that exists in the main world, you know, the real world outside the lodge, what problem exists that could be aided by a Masonic teaching? Try to be as specific as possible. Let's talk about it. Now, continuing in a little bit of a esoteric theme at the top of this episode, talking about Egypt and things, there was another article that caught my eye within this particular magazine. Now, this article is not very long and is not a to be continued. We're going to finish this one here in one swoop. And it's called Fraternity of Osiris, Temple of Memphis. Now, this immediately threw up some flags in my head. I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, Osiris and Memphis. I start thinking about this thing called the Black Rite of Memphis that's mentioned in a few different books out there is something that perhaps was the progenitor to the Grecian mysteries and things. But then I was thinking, well, is this about Memphis Mizraim and all of these kinds of things? But it's by Reverend A.W. Witt. And so what I found really interesting about this as I started to read it was that this was not about any of those things. It's a pitch for a new fraternity in Kansas. Let's see what he has to say. Fraternity of Osiris, Temple of Memphis, by Reverend A.W. Witt. Health, Fraternity, and Ethics. A most comprehensive and constructive program is what the Temple of Memphis, or the Osirian Fraternity, is offering business and professional men of Kansas City. More and more men are realizing that not all ailments are curable by their family doctors, that not all fraternal orders give peace of mind and instruction, and that not all ethical, religious, mystical, and ritualistic questions can be answered by their respective ministers. Mindful of these deficiencies existing at present, Temple of Memphis, Fraternity of Osiris, has been brought to the heart of America. Our temple works under the authority of Dr. R. S. Clymer, Grand Master of the most exalted Rosicrucian Fraternity of America, whose see is at Beverly Hall, Quakertown, Pennsylvania. While this, the Mother Temple, is but in its third year, it shows a vigorous growth and an intense interest on the part of its membership. In addition to what the Temple of Memphis offers, as indicated in the preceding paragraph, its ritualism is of a distinct character, full of beauty, romance, and loftiness in conception, inspiring and exalting. It far surpasses the realization that its candidates had hoped to receive. A new member, after receiving the 3 degrees which the Temple of Memphis offers and hearing the lectures explaining the ritualism, was asked his impressions. He confessed that when he applied for membership, he was dubious about the benefit he would receive. This man, being a member of the most widely known fraternal organizations, thought he had learned and received all there was to fraternalism. After receiving the Osirian degrees, he realized that our ritualism was of a different character, vastly more profound and exalted, yet withal simple and easily comprehended. He realized that the back of our Temple of Memphis, Fraternity of Osiris, is the great and only true Rosicrucian fraternity with its romance and history, its vast storehouse of useful knowledge under whose authority and guidance our temple works. This member found that if he wanted knowledge on health, applied psychology, mysticism, philosophy, symbolism, and eugenics, in fact, any knowledgeable respective of man and his improvement, he could receive the same from our temple. Further, he found that if he desired to advance in the studies of the great mysteries, he could do so by applying to the Grand Master for personal instruction on the 8th priesthood. In the words of a new member, quote, I have been a member of a number of different organizations, but the Temple of Memphis is the most instructive of them all. I have obtained much good and so much valuable information in general regarding health and how to obtain it. As you know, all of my work is indoors, and I was in a bad shape mentally and physically. But since I had received instruction and listened to the lectures after ritualism, I feel I have become a new man. It has changed my outlook on life. I work with more zest and get more out of my work." End quote. At each meeting after the work of the ritual is over, the high priest delivers extemporaneous lectures appropriate to the several degrees. The ritual being but a skeleton, it is the aim of the temple to clothe this skeleton with enlightening and inspiring vestiture, making each discourse a living and vital thing. Thus the members receive a message which, while lofty and exalted, is practical and livable, and which, when carried out in their homes, workshops, or offices, brings them health, success, and happiness. For example, here are the titles of the last three lectures given by the High Priest on May 15th, quote, "Health and How to Obtain It." On May 22nd, "Constructive Thinking, Its Relation to Health and Success in Fields of Endeavor." On May 29th, "The Law of Vibration." Prior to each meeting, between 6:30 and 8 p.m., the High Priest holds a clinical session at the meeting hall, where private interviews are given to the members. It is here where the High Priest listens to their problems, secrets, troubles, and heartaches. All are assured sound advice, helpful suggestions, sympathetic counsel, and warm friendship. Those who have problems are given sound, constructive advice on all matters, this being the usual basis for their unhappiness. All the claimants for the High Priest's attention are psychoanalyzed, and their secrets and confidence are securely locked in his breast. For according to the vow the High Priest assumes when he is ordained by the Grand Master, he is under strict obligation to keep all confidences and secrets inviolable. For him to disclose these to anyone would lay himself open to be unfrocked and his ordination revoked. In this way, the temple is a gathering place, offering fellowship, protection, fraternalism, and learning. It is a haven of peace and tranquility, and a means of getting away from the strife and sordidness of the materialism of the world. The temple instructs and admonishes and points out the laws of life, health, and prosperity. It does not sit in the judgment, nor does it condemn. The leaders of the Temple of Memphis have in mind the inculcation of the Master Teacher. Quote, "Inasmuch as ye have done it unto the least of these, ye have done it unto me." End quote. Those that come to us for help, no matter of what nature, find no deaf ear nor cold reception, but receive the most careful and sympathetic consideration. Their previous position, occupation, and condition need not to be a detriment to their gaining admission to our noble fraternity. We are ever ready and willing to stretch forth a helping hand to those who seek our aid, who aspire for better things, and who want instruction. As Osirians, we do not expect to enroll angels, saints, and stainless individuals. If the world were filled with saints, there would be no need for our fraternity. And here again, we are reminded of the Master's saying, quote unquote, "It is the sick that need me, and not the whole. It is the sick that need us." Those that are afflicted in body, in mind, and in heart. Who of the human family is free from cares, imperfections, and weaknesses of whatever sort? But the temple expects that those who come to us for help will make every effort for self-improvement so that they become a credit to themselves and to the fraternity. As in the case of the Master Teacher, whose disciples found fault with him in his acceptance of the Magdalene, so are those of our members who self-righteously would condemn our good work of ministering to those who need us. The temple would remind these self-righteous members of their imperfections when they applied for and received aid from our fraternity. And inasmuch as they were not turned away but were accepted, so now they should be most willing to serve in turn. The Temple of Memphis is not only a lodge room for ritualism, but it is an institution in whose halls of learning the members imbibe much many-sided knowledge that equips them for all phases of their routine life. Being freed from infirmities and weakness, in a short time and feeling better and more vigorous, they are able to cope with their daily tasks with renewed energy and vision. That is why our members, who have received benefits, are loudest in their acclaim of our great work. The lectures given to members after each degree are entirely original. They are always different, so that none are bored, but are always assured of hearing something new and helpful. They receive a livable message which is profound and elevating yet practical. They carry away with them food for thought, an ideal to live up to, and a goal to climb to. They come away inspired to dare, to do, to achieve, and to create noble works. Owing to the fact that the High Priest has been in close contact with the Grand Master Dr. R.S. Clymer, For the past 15 years, making a yearly pilgrimage to the headquarters of the order, he has gained such knowledge that enables him to enlighten his brothers. The members are admonished to translate their instruction into nobility of living so as to become worthy of being called an Osirian. For it is only through living up to our teachings that members become outstanding citizens in their respective communities. Since a community is a group of individuals, and since the temple endeavors to improve the individual, it follows that the community is better off if its citizens are healthy, self-respecting, law-abiding, and charitable. The members of the Memphis Temple are ever reminded of their responsibility to divine law, to the law of cause and effect, and they are expected to demonstrate in their daily activities the value of their training. Through the efforts of Brother Gerard, the membership director petitions for the 3 degrees of the temple have been coming in rapidly. On May 15th, a class of 8 were instructed in the 1st degree of the Osirian Rite. A class of 10 took their 2nd degree on May 22nd, and on May 29th, 12 received the Royal Purple Degree. A group of 25 is promised for the 1st degree when the temple convenes on June 12th. What makes this temple different from all other fraternal organizations, and in what way does it serve a purpose not filled by others? This can be answered as the ancients always answered a question. Where else can a man derive benefits embodying all the features already covered in the preceding paragraphs in one organization and from a competent teacher who understands his fellow men so thoroughly? With the advantages Temple of Memphis possesses in that it is directly under the guiding hand of the true Rosicrucian fraternity, with its traditions, its long history, exalted and profound teachings, is it any wonder that our temple is becoming such a potent factor in the life of Kansas City? With such a growth as this temple has enjoyed in its very brief career, the members have every reason to rejoice in its accomplishments and to anticipate a great and influential work for the heart of America. All right, well, there you have this kind of pitch for this new fraternity in the heart of America, the Fraternity of Osiris, Temple of Memphis, and Kansas City. Who do I know that's out there? Alex Powers. So my plan is to put Alex Powers on the spot and get him on the program to tell us more about the history of this fraternity. What happened to it? Where'd it go? Let's see what he can figure out. He is our historian out in the Masonic world. He runs the Historical Light Masonic podcast, all about all things history of Freemasonry. He's also the director of the Kansas Lodge of Research. So there's probably nobody better to talk about this. But I'll put him on the spot and see if we can get him on here in the next few weeks to talk a little bit more about this interesting fraternity. Well, right in the middle of the program here, I wanted to tell you about a couple more neat things. So some of you have asked in the past, hey, I heard this rumor that you had this other podcast that's about the paranormal. I do. It's called Beyond the Fourth Veil. It's not super popular. It's a podcast about, you know, various different types of things. Episode 1 was the sightings. Episode 2 was Tales from Skinwalker Ranch. Episode 3 was about cryptids. You know, episode 4 was about ghost hunting. So we talk about that kind of stuff. And because you're Masons, you know, it's probably cool to know that basically everybody who's been on the show has been a Mason, even though we don't talk about Masonry on the program. But if you're interested, check out fourthveil.com. It just has links to our YouTube videos where we go live. And it's a lot of fun and we talk about some cool stuff. Speaking of Skinwalker Ranch, those who have an interest in that, the episode we did, Tales from Skinwalker Ranch with Ben Williams. Ben Williams and I went out there. There may be something special coming for those folks out there who are producers of the program, contributors, fellows, so anybody who contributes to the program. You'll be the first to know about something kind of cool that's on the back end of the website, wcypodcast.com/something. Well, I'll let you know later. But I'm working on a little bit of a project there. We've got images that I took when we went on the trip to Skinwalker Ranch, as well as the audio and video clips from that, which will be a lot of fun. Now, one of the things that I like to do in the show is to put a showcase on some sort of a topic that might be Masonic related, even though it's like peripherally related. And so I check for science news and grammar news, you know, the liberal arts and sciences. An article that popped up when I looked for some science news, and this really isn't Masonic or anything, but I thought this was just fascinating, right? How about this article from 1921, April 2nd, coming from the Science Service, Washington, D.C., Science News Bulletin, on page 2, America's Stalest Bread Discovered in Colorado. Quote, Washington, April. The oldest and stalest bread in North America has been discovered. Some 500 or more years ago, one of the original Americans, a dweller of the cliffs in what is now Mesa Verde National Park, Colorado, forgot to eat his supper, and Dr. J. Walter Fox, archaeologist of the Smithsonian Institute, has found the cereal portion of it. Through all of these years, the dry air of that region has preserved this ancient fried cornbread made into a form similar to the modern American griddle cake or a Mexican tortilla. This ancient food was found on the plaza of Oak Tree House, one of the many cliff dweller ruins that Dr. Fox has unearthed and reconstructed. There was also found the slanting stones between which the housewife of the ancient community crushed the corn, and the oven, the straw brush she used in scraping up the cornmeal, had laid near through the centuries. You know, just little bits like that, it really pays to look up weird stuff from the past. So as I was researching things to talk about, something hit me. I was thinking, you know what, we've covered a couple science topics here in the last few weeks. What about something as interesting as writing, creative writing, or the art of writing? And one thing that came across when everybody says, hey, what's the most popular writer of all time? Everybody always goes Shakespeare. Well, that's really interesting. You know, there's this whole controversy if Shakespeare is Francis Bacon or vice versa. But as I was doing some searching, I thought I'd give you some tidbits on things that I found that were really interesting here. One is that there's a book called Shakespeare, Creator of Freemasonry. The byline says, being a remarkable examination of the plays and poems, which proves incontestably that these works were saturated in Masonry, that Shakespeare was a Freemason and the founder of the fraternity, by Alfred Dodd, past master, editor of the Alfred Dodd editions of Shakespeare's Sonnets, etc., London Writer and Company, Paternoster House, E.C. I'd like to read just the preface of the book for you, which states, this book is a straightforward compilation of specific statements from the pen of the author of the Shakespearean plays. They constitute definitive evidence that modern Freemasonry was known to him and that he employed Masonic imagery and symbolism in his works. Circumstantial evidence is brought to show that he must have sat in many a speculative lodge and participated in the rites. Many learned brethren believe that Freemasonry with its 3 degrees was created by Brother Anderson and Desaguliers out of a crude operative rite 1 degree from 1717 to 23 or 38. Quote, the 1717 theory, unquote, is no longer tenable in the views of evidence that the Elizabethan brethren, quote-unquote, moralized on tools and spiritualized temples, end quote, in 1589. The business of the 1717 brethren was not the creation of symbolic masonry, but the introduction of an ethical cult to the open world by a new type of combine, the federation of all secret independent lodges under a central head, the Grand Lodge, that had hitherto practiced their rites hidden from the eyes of all men. The brethren of that era had bequeathed to them a precious heritage handed to them by their fathers, and no less than an ascending pyramid of degrees based on the three-craft rite, the Royal Arch, through knightly and sovereign orders to the 33rd degree. Speculative Freemasonry was born in Elizabethan era. Shakespeare took an active part in its genesis. The story is told that the great Shakespeare folio of 1623, the greatest Masonic book in the world, the symbolism was buried in secret and left to grow and root itself like a bulb in the dark for 100 years. The emergence of the Masons in 1723 was a planned emergence, the centenary of the 1623 folio. William Shakespeare was not only a Freemason, he was the father and founder of the fraternity, the writer of the rituals, Alfred Dodd. If you'd like more information, I'll put a link. There'll be a link back to this book, but it got me thinking about Freemasonry and Shakespeare. Was there a connection? I don't know. What do you guys think? Was that all baloney? Well, from MasonicCode.com, they say, William Shakespeare, Master Mason, a biography. For as long as anyone can remember, Shakespeare has been claimed to be a Freemason. This aspect of the life of William Shakespeare has been asserted from both within and without Freemasonry. Significantly, the most numerous and loudest voices are those of Masons themselves. They seem very sure that the bard was one of their own. In the last century, Baconist enthusiast called Alfred Dodd wrote a book no longer available, asserting that Shakespeare was actually the quote-unquote founder of Freemasonry. This folly aside, he did also provide a large body of evidence from the plays pointing to Shakespeare's inside knowledge of Masonry. Dodd was a Freemason himself, although he didn't seem to have scrambled very high up the winding staircase. The subject was more recently aired in the winter of 1998 edition of the Inn Lodge Journal Freemasonry Today. 1. The author of the piece, Peter Dawkins, who claims not to be a Freemason, finds numerous cases of arcane Masonic knowledge in the plays. He cites examples in Love's Labor Lost, Henry V, Coriolanus, Measure for Measure, Julius Caesar, Henry VI, Part 2, and The Tempest. A version of his paper is posted on the Sir Bacon website. A particularly spectacular indication of Masonic interest in Shakespeare occurred at the laying of the foundation stone of the Shakespeare Memorial Theater, July of 1929. On this occasion, there was a massive Masonic ceremony, presided over by the Grand Master of the United Grand Lodge of England and attended by over 600 Masons in full regalia. The scale of this jamboree points to the fact that the craft takes the bard very serious indeed. The play, most likely to have a Masonic subtext, is one actually not mentioned by Dawkins. This is the play set in ancient Egypt of Masonic mythology, Anthony and Cleopatra. In the following paper, I will seek to demonstrate that this play is profoundly Masonic, both in spirit and substance, and could only have been written by a Royal Archmason. Now, it is interesting, he references the book that we just talked about, but also provides no links to this upcoming article. If I find it, I'll make sure I post a link back to that so that you can check it out on your own time. But I'll also provide a link back to this particular article. And as if it wasn't enough, the article spoken about in the previous article, when he talked about Shakespeare and Freemasonry coming up in Freemasonry Today, the publication of the UGLE, well, I found it. And here it is. Shakespeare and Freemasonry, Monday, 2nd of February, 2009. In July 1929, Lord Amthill, Pro-Grand Master of UGLE, accompanied by 600 Masons in full regalia, laid the foundation stone of Stratford's Shakespeare Memorial Theatre. United Grand Lodge of England perceived a link between the craft and the bard. Why? Quote, "For charity itself fulfills the law, and who can sever love from charity?" End quote. Love's Labor Lost, 4. This speech expresses the essence of a Freemason's purpose, to be a builder of love. Shakespeare was an ethical teacher. Could he have also been a Mason? Look at the dedication in the first Shakespeare folio, addressed, quote-unquote, to the most noble and incomparable pair of brethren, William Earl of Pembroke and the Philip Earl of Montgomery, end quote. Not the normal way to address a nobleman. The dedication describes Shakespeare as a, quote-unquote, so worthy a friend and fellow, while the most, though meanest, of things are made more precious when they are dedicated to temples, end quote. Masonic style inferences are numerous in the plays, some obvious, some others subtle. In Henry V, we hear of the quote-unquote singing masons building roofs of gold, while Love's Labor Lost mentions a lodge and possibly a disguised password. Arm, I will visit thee at the lodge. Jock, that's hereby. Arm, I know where it is situate. Jock, how wise you are. Arm, come, Jaquanetta. Coriolanus, 4, refers to quote-unquote apron men. You have made good work, you and your apron men. The meaning of the lambskin apron being touched upon in Measure for Measure in the satirical jest, quote, and furred with fox on lambskins too, to signify that craft, being richer than innocency, stands for the facing, end quote. The opening lines of Julius Caesar may be understood as a cryptic description of the difference between an operative Mason, a carpenter, and an accepted Freemason. Speak, what trade art thou? Why, sir, a carpenter, where is thy leather apron and thy rule? Why dost thou with thy best apparel on? You, sir, what trade are you? Truly, sir, in respect of a fine workman, I am but, as you would say, a cobbler. But what trade art thou? Answer me directly. A trade, sir, that I hope I may use with a safe conscience, which is, indeed, sir, a method of bad souls. In Henry VI, Part 2, death is touchingly embraced by Peter, an Armoire's man. Quote, here, Robin, and if I die, I give thee my apron, and will thou shalt have my hammer, and here, Tom, take all the money I have. End quote. Having won through and prevailed in right, the king declares that God in justice hath revealed the truth and innocence of this poor fellow, The Tyler, used to draw the symbolic teaching of the degree on the floor before the candidate's entrance, Gonzalo in the Tempest, may refer to this and the Masonic pillars. Quote, "For it is you that hath chalked forth the way which brought us hither. Rejoice beyond a common joy, and set it down with gold on lasting pillars," end quote. The chief character of the Tempest is, of course, Prospero, an initiatic name for the one who gives joy and prosperity by enabling others to prosper, the mark of a true Master Mason. He describes himself as, quote-unquote, Prospero, master of a full poor cell, thy no greater father, end quote. And as Prospero, the prime, reputed in dignity, and for the liberal arts without a peril, having both the key of officer and office, all dedication to closeness. A fitting ending might be to refer to the mystery of the password. Look at Love's Labor Lost. One word in secret, will you vouchsafe with me to change a word? Name it. You have a double tongue within your mask and would afford my speechless visor half. Let's part the word. No, I'll not be your half. One word in private with you ere I die. Bleat softly then. The butcher hears you cry. The tongues of mocking wenches are as keen as the razor's edge invisible, cutting a smaller hair than may be seen. Above the sense of sense so sensible seemeth their conference. Not one word more. Break off. Break off. In this mocking dialogue, the word is provided critically through the use of a capital letter code, beginning with the key, one word, and continuing with the reference to the bleat of the sacrificial lamb or word of God. Furthermore, the word is divided by C-A-T, descriptive of the mocking wench in the text, and a creature associated with the moon, the celestial sign associated with this word and pillar of Freemasonry. Here, the word is not only parted, but halved and lettered, with Shakespeare appearing to show his mastery of its meaning and usage. Was he a Mason? Peter Dawkins, director of the Francis Bacon Trust. I'll put a link back to this particular article as well. It's going to blow your mind when you take a look at that last bit about the password and how it's lettered out. They've got that first letter, you know, put together so that it spells something out. You'll check it out. I think you'll really enjoy it. Conspiracy theorists will abound. Speaking of, let's all turn on that switch. Let's turn on your inner conspiracy theorist. In your opinion, all jokes aside, is Francis Bacon Shakespeare or vice versa? And a second follow-up, was Shakespeare a Freemason? I look forward to reading your replies. To wrap it up this week, a quick just two blurbs here from the Smithsonian Institute. A lot of people don't know this, but the Smithsonian is actually named after Brother Smithson, a brother. The art of handwriting. Writing a letter in one's own hand can be an artistic art. Handwriting animates paper. The bold flares of calligraphic script shout for attention, while elegant flourishes of cursive sashay across the page. Free-spirited scribbled letters trip over each other, and distinctive dashes help direct traffic. Some crossed T's and dotted I's stand alert, and others slump or sway into the neighbors. Every message brims with the personality of the writer at the moment of interplay between hand, eye, mind, pen, and paper. The letters here from the Smithsonian Archives of American Art show that an artist might put pen to paper just as he or she would apply a line to a drawing. For each artist, a leading authority interprets how the pressure of line and sense of rhythm speak to that artist's signature style, and questions of biography arise. Does the handwriting confirm assumptions about the artist, or does it suggest a new understanding? The reason I talk about this and I wanted to close the show out is because I love handwriting letters. I write very often to friends and family in letters and cards that I send, you know, willy-nilly. I rarely get anything back because most people just don't have the time or the knack to do that kind of thing. That's totally fine. But I think it's really cool, keeping with kind of the idea of writing and grammar and creation, talking about Shakespeare. I thought this loosely fit in here. As a Mason, we have a lot of things like correspondences and official notifications and whatnot. So, one last question for you this week. For a Craftsman Plus, do you write in a journal? Do you use cursive or do you use big block letters? Do you write in all caps? Tell me how you journal. Tell me what you write. Do you write letters? Do you write more than cards? If not, why not? If you do, why do you love it? That's it for this week. I hope you really enjoyed episode 500. I want to invite you once more to head on over to wcypodcast.com to check out all the things we have to offer. One more big shout out to our contributors, fellows, producers, and legacy partners who have continued to bring this program to you for 500 episodes. It's amazing. That's it for this week, so we'll talk to you all next week. And until then, stay on the level. For Whence Came You, I'm Robert Johnson. Take care.
You've been listening to Whence Came You, a Masonic podcast featuring research papers and discussions related to Freemasonry with your host, Brother Robert Johnson. Be sure to join us for our next edition.